Good morning. So, recall our little microscope. So we had our system, and we choose a little part, and we defined by zooming in our renormalization toy. It seems to be something very simple, but something happened already. We studied this week renormalization for circle diffeomorphisms, and we used that to get a very precise, exact description of the topology of circle diffeomorphisms. So today we will be discussing the measure theory, and then later we will do geometry and bifurcation. And so we are going to discuss this today. Let's begin with a digression. And it's not very far from what we are doing, but we are going to discuss minimal contour sets. It seems to be something very different from what we have been doing so far. But in many cases where renormalization was successful, the attractor is a minimal contour set. So let's get our understanding of these guys right. And at the same moment, we will introduce a little bit what we need to know about measure theory. Okay, so let's first start with the contour set. And what's that again? That is something compact, totally disconnected. And it is perfect. And perfect means that if you take a point in your set, then you can find other points arbitrarily close. So there are no isolated points. So this is a contour set. So let's make a picture of that. So here is our contour set. But it is something compact, so there you something compact. And it is totally disconnected, so there are at least two pieces. Right? So everything is lying inside here, there is nothing outside these two pieces. But again, it is totally disconnected, so this thing has two pieces, and this thing has two pieces. Again, it is totally disconnected, so each piece will have little pieces. And you can continue this forever. And if you start to zoom in, you start here, and then you go to this one, and then you go to this one. So you're zooming in to your limit point. And so this contour set consists of all points to which you can zoom. That's a contour set. So let's do it a bit more schematically. So in first approximation, you just see a point. Yeah, like the first approximation is just a one blob. But then in second approximation, let's call that point x1. But then in second approximation, it consists of two blobs. And let's call that approximation of two blobs, x2. And of course, there's a little bit more information. This blob is contained in the big blob. And so there is a little arrow here. And this blob is contained in that blob. And so the arrows means being contained. But then on the next thing, so like this blob here corresponds to this blob, and there are two blobs inside. And so there is on the third scale, there are two blobs, two blobs, two blobs, two blobs, and they are contained like that. and this continues like this. There will be x4, etc., and there will be points, and there will be these inclusions. And now, what you can write, x is what they call the inverse limit of the xn. This inverse limit. And what it is just the set of all backward paths. And so if you start here and you choose like this backward path, and you continue now. So we start in the big blob, but then we go to that one. So our point has to be somewhere here. But then we choose that one, so our point has to be somewhere here. And so you see that every path corresponds to a point in our contour set. And that's called an inverse limit. So it looks very abstract, and this is a very general tool in topology in many places, but you should think about it sort of simple. So you have seen a middle third contour set, like in the numbers, you know. So I have difficulties really understanding how that looks like. But in terms of approximations, like all the little intervals, you can see what it is. So you should think about inverse limits as building up your space scale by scale. And so it is building up, or maybe building down, because you get to finer and finer scales, building down the space step by step. And so that's how you do that. Okay, so now that is what our contour sets are. So we did this. So now let's go to minimal contour sets. So now we start to do dynamics. So a minimal contour set that is a map from x to x, where x is a contour set, and for all x in x, the orbit of x is the whole space. So all orbits are dense. So let's try to see. So in the first step, we build up our space scale by scale. So now let's try to build up our dynamics step by step. So let's do an example, and you will see how that goes. And so let's imagine that here, again, we have our contour set, and we have a map here. And the map is minimal. So let's consider a very simple situation. So let me also erase the other picture. Then we start it sort of from scratch. So let's do the same thing. So on the first scale, our space is just a blob, and the map preserves the blob. But now we know there are blobs inside. So there's one blob, and there is another blob. And let's assume that this blob, by the map F, is mapped to that blob, and this blob is mapped back to that blob. So then what you get is, we have again, on the next scale, and you see the two blobs. And the dynamics, if you look at it on this scale, is given by this directed graph. And so first, we just had points representing the set. And now we get a directed graph, which starts to describe the dynamics. Then, of course, we still had our inclusion map. So this is a directed graph. So let's go one step further, and let's suppose that now we have two blobs inside each of them, two blobs inside of each one, and let's say that this blob goes there, this blob goes there. It has to jump back because now it is inside this one, so it has to jump back. Let's say it goes here, and let's say this one has to jump back, and let's say it goes here. And so what you see is if you start with your point somewhere here, you go here, you go here, you go here, and you come back. So this starts to look like orbits are going to be dense. And so this is it starts to look like a minimal thing. So now here we have our next scale, and we see something like we have our inclusion again, and we have some, let's say, these guys have to go here. Let's say it is like this one goes here. This one has to go back. This one has to go back. And this one has to go back. And so we get again a directed graph. And that describes the dynamic on a bit more on the next scale. And this process continues. Okay? So what you get is, the picture is the same. We have x, and we have our map. And now we have, again, our space given by this. Now it is a directed graph. And the arrows are going to recover the map. And so what we plus a map. And what that means is the directed graph coincides the structure coincides with the original map. And so in this way you can rebuild the map. Okay, so let's be more schematically. And so, on the first scale, we see like a little loop. It's a loop of just one step. On the second step, again, we see just a little loop. But this loop has like one step, and this loop inside has like two steps. So it just sort of erased. Very rough schematically, I draw this other loop. And then on the next scale, there's again a loop. And so if you take this a little bit apart, you just see one loop. And so we are very schematic. But now there are also these inclusion maps. And what you see is that this loop sort of goes around twice. So if you take this loop, it sort of goes around once, and it goes around twice. And if you take this loop, again. So if you start here, you go, this is the first turn, you go, and you're back. And so this loop also just turns around twice. You see? And so all these inclusions, they have like a winding number. So our inverse limit is just a sequence of loops, and from each loop you go around twice in the previous scale. You see? Okay, so this is the simplest example. And you see, all the time we are speaking about one scale, a finer scale, the next scale. So that is like zooming in. So this picture smells like renormalization. It is, we are doing a digression, but we are doing renormalization. So okay, so let's generalize this picture. And there is an obvious generalization. And so what you have here, we have one loop. So we could use as many loops as we want. So you could start with a minimal counter set, which consists, say, of two loops. And on the next scale, we have three loops. And so in each loop here is in maybe, let's say, this one. So let's use a color. So, say this loop here, if you project it down, it's going to do maybe this one. Okay, so there's an inclusion, and there's sort of winding around. And there's sort of, you see. And this can continue like this, and maybe the next time we have two loops, and maybe the next time we have again two loops, and maybe the next time we have tons of loops. But always finite. And you continue like this. And that corresponds again with this picture, but now there are more loops in the picture. So there are more blobs. But you can still speak, as what we did there, as the inverse limit of this very schematic picture. Really in the same way as what we did with one loop. But now we have tons. You know, so let's look at this case here. There's some information. And you see here, this red loop winds around one time to this one and one time to that one. Let's be a bit more explicit here. There are matrices here. And we call this the winding matrix. And let's say it is like this. Do we have a blue?
Purple.
And so let's say that the red one just goes around the red one. And we can record that.
Oops.
So say this is red. This is red. This is going to be a 2x2 matrix, right? Blue and blue, purple and purple. And say, let's say, and now we record, the red one goes around one time to the red one. And it goes zero time to the purple one. So now let's take the purple one here. And let's say that it winds around like this. It goes around one time to the purple one here. But it also turns around one time to the red one. And so the purple one uses one time the purple one, and it uses one time the red one. And so for each of these inclusions of loops, there's a first winding matrix, there's a second winding matrix, etc., and a third winding matrix. And so this inverse limit is given by a sequence of matrices. This is very algebraic, something you will be, and in the exercise you will see, we can do exercises with this. We can do calculations and study how this minimal dynamics is working. And we will get there, you will see. So this is an important thing. And you know, and for people who studied homology, you can think about this as loops. So this has a first homology group. These are loops, so this has a first homology group. And this inclusion induces this matrix as action on homology. So we start to do lots of topology, and homology starts to show up. So it starts to, the structure is slowly building up. Okay. And now there is a little theorem. Every minimal Cantor set can be represented as an inverse loop thing. And in particular, the information you need is a sequence of matrices. And so every minimal Cantor set is represented by a sequence of matrices. And we like to deal with matrices. That's easy stuff. No. Completely abstract. Just forget everything we discussed before. We just have an abstract Cantor set. You can represent it like this. Yeah. It is a minimal thing. And so it is something like that. And so, and this thing is the same as this, where the map is coming from the directed graph structure. The picture. And it is let's do a little digression, and you see, and you, the proof. Let's do the proof. And it is just one word. I will make the picture explaining the word, but you will see immediately why this is true. And the word, you know what the word is. Yeah, so what you can do is, so here we have our system, and here we have our little u, and now we are looking at the first return map here. But, like in the circle case, there was one piece which returned in Ln steps, at the L part, the Ln part, and there was one part which returned in Rn steps. And so this Un as level of renormalization corresponds to two loops. And then the next scale, there will be somewhere inside here, you will get the next loop thing. So when un plus 1 will also give you, and there will be an inclusion here. I can tell you already, in that case of our circle things, if you would have a plus type of renormalization, the matrix will be 1, 1, 0, 1. We will come back later a little bit more precisely. And so just by zooming in, you are starting to refine, and the first return maps correspond to the loops. And these are the ways of returning. And so these loops, and so apparently if you look at this blob here, there are three ways to return there. And so these graphs are approximations of how you're returning to little pieces. Okay. So So now let's discuss what we mean by measure theory for dynamical systems. Most of you will know, but let me just recall. So if you have an F, say a minimal counter set, then you say mu is an invariant measure for F if mu of a pre-image is the same as the measure of your set. And so you have we have our x, and we have a blob here and a blob here. So if this is our set A, and remember this blob goes there, so this is the set F inverse of A. And so the measure here, you can think about the measure as dropping sand on the set. So the amount of sand which is living here is the same as the amount of sand which is living here. Blob, blob. So the blobs have the same weight. So that is an invariant measure. And now we get a little bit more technical. There is something called an ergodic measure. So an ergodic measure is a measure which has only one piece. And so what the formal definition is that if A is an invariant set, then the measure of A is either zero or it is one. So it has to be an ergodic measure is a probability measure. And that means that the measure of the whole thing is one. So you take 1 kilo of sand and you put it on the space. And so what is not ergodic is something like this. Here you have your space, and there is some subset one here sitting, and this set is invariant under F, and there is another set sitting here, and this set is invariant. But this set contains some positive measure, and this set contains some positive measure. So in this case, you see, the measure is not ergodic because the space, the measure, consists of two pieces. And if you have something like that, what you say is, forget one piece and just concentrate on one part of it. And so if you're studying invariant measures, then you can restrict yourself to ergodic measures. That is what they call the ergodic decomposition theorem. So every measure can be written as a sum of pieces. Lots of pieces sometimes. Okay. And then there is a beautiful theorem, which most of you will know. Birkhoff ergodic theorem. And so what we do is say F It is not about minimal. This is an extremely general theorem, but we are dealing with minimal complex set. So allow me to formulate it as a minimal complex set. It really doesn't play any role, but I can make an easier picture. So you have a minimal contour set, and mu is an ergodic measure. So then, let's take f from x to r continuous, and then you can start to take a time average. And so let me make a picture. Let me first make a little picture. So here we have our function phi. And we take a point. And we just start to iterate our point. And at each point, say after I steps, we measure the value of our function. So we measure values of our function, and then we take the average. And Birkhoff found that this is equal to the integral of the function with the average. So what you can say that this is like the time average. And this is the space average. So time average and space average is the same thing. This holds in a complete generality. It's sort of a very strong theorem with lots of consequences. Yeah. Like uniform in which sense? Like if you take bounded functions?
If you have some topology.
Yeah. If you take... If the functions can be a bit wild, and that might screw up things. If you take indicator functions on our blobs, you will see uniform convergence independent of the blob you choose. And so if you take a blob, let's do that for the that's good, let's do that. Let's see. No. It was about you see. Oh, I should have written here. So if your question is it always uniquely ergodic?
Yes.
Then the answer is absolutely no. There are minimal contour sets which have two pieces. There are minimal contour sets which have infinitely many pieces. There are minimal contour sets which have many folds as ergodic measures. So it sounds very innocent, our pictures. Very innocent, but... No, it's not uniquely ergodic. Not in general. There are uniquely ergodic examples, but there are also examples where there are two measures. Two ergodic measures. You can cut the contour set in sort of two pieces, and one piece of the measure lives here, and the other piece lives here. And this is ergodic, and this part is ergodic. No, they are completely intertwined. It's a complete disaster. Because it is minimal.
Yeah, it's not
really ergodic. Yeah. And it can be very dramatic, not uniquely ergodic. So there are examples where there are two pieces, two ergodic measures, but there are also examples where there are infinitely many pieces. And there are also examples where this infinity is like a continuum. we will do an exercise this afternoon to make two. And if you like, you can also make one. I think if you're able to make one with two, if you get that, I think you will be able to make one which has countably many measures. To make it a continuum, you have to work a little harder. So it is just fiddling with the matrices.
But that example
that
in small systems.
Yeah, all these guys, all of them, not all of them. Like there are examples in the unimodal family, which have two measures of billion measures. Yeah, absolutely. Okay. You know, and that is not, not digress. Let's continue the digression a little bit more. So if you have, so we are doing topological dynamics so far, and we are looking at measures and continuous functions. But these people who are doing ergodic theory, their spaces are just measure spaces. So it's a much looser thing. And there are theorems that if you have an ergodic measure, this measure is concentrated on some minimal set. Not compact, but some minimal set. And so, and you know, general measures is a disaster. So we should see traces of that in the compact context, and that happens. And so it's not surprising that these minimal Condor sets can get crazy. They can approximate as crazy stuff as you want. You have heard about entropy. So there are minimal Condor sets which have infinite entropy. You know, these are abstract Condor sets. They are not embedded Condor sets.
Yeah, but I mean, you don't have something like a
So, so we will do one and two dimensional dynamics. And in one and two dimensional dynamics, all Condor sets are just like the middle third Condor set. So in dimension 1 and 2, they are just nothing funny going on. In dimension 3, forget about it. So we are doing something completely abstract at the moment. We just have, so let's not look at the embeddings of them so far. But like generally speaking, no, they will be tame. And sort of renormalization will be taking care of that. You will see. And later, when we start to do the geometry, we will also start to see something about the embedding of them.
It's not so dark.
Okay. So let's do one example of this. Let's go back to our super simple case. And so this is our minimal Condor set. And let's look at the super simple level, the first level. So this blob goes there and this blob goes there. And there is a measure. But now the measure is invariant. So the measure that you see in the pre-image is the same as the measure here. And so these two blobs, they have the same measure. But this is a probability measure. So they have to weigh it. So it has to be half of the mass has to be here, and half of the mass has to be here. So now let's take this is say A, and let's take phi as the have a function which is 1 here and 0 here. Okay, how do you call it? Indicator function. Now then you see, so according to Birkhoff, this converts to the measure, to the integral of the measure of this function. But it is like the function is 1 here and 0 here, and the weight is a half. And so this integral is just a half. But if you look on this side, you are just counting how many times you are here. And so this is the number of visits to A divided by N. And you can say that is like the frequency of A. So apparently, according to Birkhoff, the frequency of hitting A is a half. But of course, because if you are here, you go there and you're back. You go there, you're back. So every second step, you're back. So the frequency is a half. And so in this case, the Birkhoff theorem is very transparent. And you should in generally think about the ergodic theorem as the measure of a set, like in this case. Maybe I should have written it more carefully. And this is the measure of the set. So what we see here is that the frequency of visiting a set A is the same as the measure of A. And so and this is the way you should think about it. And that means that the measure is telling you how the orbit is spread to the space. And so what they say is, so this is orbits are distributed. And you know, distributed in a probability. In this sense, are distributed according to mu. And that's the same thing. So these ergodic measures, they tell you how the orbits are running around in a frequency sense. Okay, so now let's start. We can still do that. So now let's go to making these invariant measures. So how to make invariant measures for x is one of our minimal counter sets. Now you see, if you go to this example, we had like, here we have our first level, and the measure have to put total weight here. Then the next one, we had two pieces, and the two pieces in the loop both had weight a half. And you can imagine that in the next scale, because it goes around as a periodic behavior, there has to be a quarter here, quarter here, a quarter here, and everywhere a quarter. So each blob, so the blobs of the loop all have the same measure. And like here, half, a quarter, and a quarter. And so what you do, so this was the simple case, but now let's go to the general case. And so let's take mu is a measure. This is the space of invariant measures. And let's take let's go to the n scale. So we see two blobs. This is xn. And now you see that now we put in the blobs on the loop. So there are blobs along the loop. And there are blobs here. And now the same thing we have here. All these guys, they have weight 1. M1. And all the blobs on the other loop, they have weight 2. So what you can say is, say Mn is the invariant measures on scale n. And you see they are just characterized by two numbers. So we know that our measure puts equal weights along this loop and equal weights on this loop. So what we see is that we have a measure mu, which is invariant for m, and that is mapped, just in this case, in this case to two numbers, but if you have many loops, to many numbers. And of course, you see that in this case, you can label this just as some Euclidean space, like in this case R2. Okay? So what you see is we have our space M of invariant measures on our contour sets, might be lots of them, and somehow we project this to the space of invariant measures on that scale. For people who are professional, what you do is you take the measure which lives on the whole sigma algebra, and you restrict the measure to the sigma algebra restricted, generated by this part. But you see the picture.
I don't understand what you're saying that it's equal to RD, right? So you're saying that at that scale there are many choices?
Yeah, I don't know what it is going to be. But it could be, you can put, if you put equal weight here.
That's the only choice.
Yeah, but you can put different weights. You can choose any combination you want.
Ah.
In this case, there's only one loop, so you have only one choice. But if you have many loops, you can fiddle a little bit. And now.
So within each loop, you have to have equal weights.
Yeah.
Choose how to divide.
Yeah. Because, like, if you start here, this is the preimage of that one, so this guy has to have the same weight as that one. And so. Can you say it again? No, let's do it a little bit general. Only ergodic measures are probability measures. So just let's we like homology. You will see. And because you see that this thing, like in our case, is the first homology of this space. But it doesn't matter. Okay. So now Stefano asked, so you have tons of possibilities. And you have tons of possibilities at this scale. But if you go one scale deeper, that is going to restrict your possibilities. So what we are going to do is, we go one scale deeper, and we also have a projection to that one. And now we are going to see what is going to happen here. So the claim is that by looking at the measures one scale deeper, you will get more precise information of these guys. Let's do an example. This will be fine. So example. So let's say we have a system with two loops, and there are many guys here, and we have weight 1 here, and we have one weight 2 here. So our measures project to R2. And this is the M1 axis, and this is the M2 axis. And now we go to the next scale, and Maybe let me put primes here, okay, if you allow me. There are primes here. So in here we also have blobs, M1. At this moment, yes. Let's be completely free. And here on this one we have mass 1 and 2. And now you project again to the space of measures. And now let's see what is living here. And you can guess what it is going to be. Let's do the same picture again. So here we have the purple loop. And here we have the purple loop. And here we have, the pink loop. And here we have the purple loop. And here we have the purple loop. So let's say that the red loop goes around the red loop. And so our matrix, like we had red and pink, and we had red and pink. So the red loop just goes around one times here. So the red goes one to the one, and zero ones to the purple. But the purple one goes once to the purple here, and once through the pink one here. So that's going to be one and one. Now let's see. I sort of flipped it just around. So you see, I did this wrong. Let me make it, sorry. The labeling was just wrong, sorry. That was it. And so let's do this again. So we have our matrix, and the pink ones are the second ones, and the purple ones are the first ones. So the purple one, say, goes once around the purple and once around the pink. So we get once around the purple and once about the pink. And the pink ones just goes once around the pink and zero ones around the pink. But now let's look like at this blob here. So the purple one will pass by here. So it will put a little mass here. So what you see is that the weight you see here will get at least the weight M1 here. So, and that is it, because the other guy, so the rest of this loop will never come back here, so there are no other contributions. If you take this loop, it will just go here and it will not contribute anything. So if you know the weight here and here, then you know the weight here. And this is the formula. And if you look at a blob here, now then you see that the pink one will come true. So there will be some pink contribution. But the purple one will also come true. So you also see the other one. You see? So our winding matrix, and this was our winding matrix, tells you exactly how the measures go from here to here. So the action here is just the winding matrix. And so we have winding, and that is just the action on the measures from scale to scale. And then here we will get the inverse limit according to those measures. And these projections, they will extend to this limit. And then the theorem says that this is an isomorphism. So the theorem says that all invariant measures are constructed by these type of projections. So and now, do you allow me 2 minutes more? Then we can wrap this up, and then you can do the exercises later. It is sort of funny what happens. So to understand invariant measures, we have to look at this scale. We have to look at what happens in R2. So let's see what happens. So here, we have R2, right, that corresponds to, say, the nth scale. And here we have the next guy, which is also just R2. And here we have our little matrix, 1, 1, 0, 1. So, like these numbers here, they are the weights. So this should be positive numbers. And so Stefano asked, are you completely free? Now, if you only look at the nth scale, it can be anything here in the positive quadrant. So invert measures on the scale n corresponds to the positive quadrant. But now, on the next scale, the measures correspond to the positive quadrant. So, and now let's ask Stefano's question again. Are you completely free here? No, you have to be in the image of this under this matrix. So, and if you look, so I think that this cone is going to squeeze to this cone. And so you were not completely free. You have to be in this cone. And so, and now let's say that on the next scale, and so the claim is that the deeper you go in the scales, the more information you get about your measure. So you go to the next scale, and let's say our matrix was 1, 0, 1, 1. So then you see, let's see what this scale here, let's make it red because now it is coming nicer. So if you use this scale here, now then under this matrix, I think it is going to be squeezed like here. And now if you squeeze this further up, I think it will be squeezed like here. So now you see what happens. If you if you continue your sequence, if you continue here, and you always have one of these matrices, like 1, 1, 0, 1, and the next 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, and the next 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, and you continue like that, and then each time you will really shrink your cone. And so in the limit, because that's what they say, the space of invariant measures correspond to the limit. So you see, so each step, your cone is getting smaller. So and in the limit, you just get a line. So in this example, the dimension of the invariant, the space of invariant measures, is just one. And that means on the minimal counter set constructed by this winding matrix, there's only one invariant measure. And so that means X is uniquely ergodic. And so but now to yeah. Can you say it again? We leave it as an exercise. But you can imagine, like if you have a simple matrix like this, or let's do it here, you see the cone is definitely contracted. But you can cook up a matrix, and you can do something like that. I leave it to as an exercise. You can choose the matrix such that this cone is contracted to like a ridiculously fat cone on this scale. Yeah, of course, this you can do this in any dimension. But let's do this one. So we are going to stop them. So if you make this contraction of the cone extremely weak, and on the next time even weaker, then in the limit, you will get a fat cone. And that will mean that there are two invariant measures. Like you have a whole line of invariant measures. And like the corners will be ergodic measures. And now you can, so that we do that as an exercise. So construct matrices such that you get actually a cone of invariant measures. And then you can go to more loops, and then you can start to make three measures, and if you let the number of loops grow, you can make infinitely many measures. So sorry for being running over time.